Hi, my name is Melissa. I'm a scientist here at Science North, and I'm here to talk to you today a little bit about electricity. Now, what exactly is electricity? Electricity is a force driven by electric charges. Now, electric charges can come in both positive and negative forms. When we have charges that are flowing, when we have charges that are moving and powering electrical devices, we say that we have current electricity. On the other hand, when we have separate charges that are in an imbalance, we call that static electricity. Now, how does one create static electricity? I think probably had a few of you may have this idea. The easiest and most fun way to create static electricity. Now, another really interesting way that we can detect static electricity is by using water. Now, water has molecules that are polar. So that means that although the molecule is electrically neutral as a whole, some parts of it may be slightly negative, some parts of it may be slightly positive. And essentially that means that we should get an attractive force between the water and something that is charged with static electricity. So again, we need to make contact with materials in order to generate static electricity. So I'm just going to make some contact with this fur and PVC pipe. Turn on the stream of water. And hopefully we'll get a chance to observe that attractive force. Yes. So earlier I mentioned that charges come in both positive and negative forms. Sometimes it can be difficult to know through static electricity whether I've charged something positively or negatively. So what I want to do here is charge up this balloon. So when I charge a balloon with fur, I know that I get a negatively charged balloon. Good contact and friction, transferring some charges. Now I want to do the same thing to a second balloon. Now if I charge both balloons with like charges, we know that likes repel. So I should be able to observe a repulsive force in between these two balloons, which we sort of do. Now I'll just let that go. So if I were to now take this rod and this fur, I'll be able to tell whether I'm having an attractive force or a repulsive force is going to tell me how this rod has been charged. It seems like I'm getting a little bit of an attractive force here, closer to here where I charged the balloon earlier. So this tells me if the balloon is a negative charge, then I've got a positive charged rod. So I'm going to charge up this balloon one more time. And see what combination we get. Now when we rub two materials together, it can be hard to tell which one is going to become positively charged and which one will become negatively charged, if at all. Okay? Now this has to do with sort of an innate quality of different materials as to what kind of charge, whether they like to gain or lose electrons. So right here, I'm not seeing too great of a force. Well, let's try to get a little bit more static built up on here. Now this appears to be neutral. So this combination of plastic and silk doesn't generate enough static electricity under these humid conditions to affect our balloon. So I've brought out a different electrostatic device here. It's an electrostatic generator, and I've invited my friend Sarah over so we can kick it into high voltage. Thanks for coming.
Absolutely.
So Sarah's got a hand on top of the electrostatic generator. When I turn the machine on, I'm going to get a belt that starts moving. And just like I was charging things with friction earlier, we're getting some friction that's happening between the belt and the roller at the bottom of the machine and another roller at the top of the machine. So that's where our friction and that's where our static electricity is coming from. And since Sarah has got a hand on top, the charge imbalance is going to transfer to her. Now, usually when we're talking about high voltage, we're talking about a voltage level that could be harmful to living things. Now, this machine can generate static charges up to about 300,000 volts, but it's perfectly safe because it can't generate a substantial current. Now, this is also a really cool demonstration of a static electric field. Okay, so we can see each one of Sarah's hairs that are getting repelled. So there's a repulsive force between her head and her hair and each one of her hairs. So they're all trying to push away from each other. Now, another interesting thing about static electricity is that the charges want to move from an area of high potential to an area of low potential, like the ground. At any way possible. The path of least resistance kind of applies to static electricity. So if Sarah were to bring her hand out, I'm going to approach and I'm going to give the electricity a path to balance out that difference in potential. Ooh. And we can see the charges escaping from her head, through my body, down to the ground. We can mostly just see them leaving her head. The rest of the path is invisible. Ooh, that was a good one, sorry. That'll be the last one. That was kind of mean. But static electricity is a lot of fun. And for the most part, it can be safe when worked with safely. So other than static electricity, we have what I referred to earlier as current electricity. So when we have electricity flowing in an electrical circuit and powering an electrical device, this is where we have current. Now, in order to create a circuit, we need to have a minimum of three things in a simple circuit. One of those will be a power supply. Okay, in this case, we've plugged into an outlet. This could be a battery in some cases. We also need conductors. We need to be able to send the electricity where we want it to go. And we also need a load. So here, the load is going to be a light bulb. Now, there are two main kinds of circuits. And one of them is called a series, and one of them is called a parallel. And I want to do just a couple of demonstrations with each of those. Now, in a series circuit, the components follow one after the other. So I've got the wires going to the first load, and then to the second, and then back. Now, the first thing to notice here is that this light is dimmer than it was the first time. This light is dimmer than it would be if it were plugged in alone. Now I can add more components to this series circuit and observe the same sort of thing. And the lights are dimmer still. So you can imagine adding more and more components into a series circuit where the lights would be so dim that they would barely even be on. And that would be actually very impractical to wire even one room in your house in series. So if you had one thing go out, then they all would. Okay? A series circuit is sort of like all or nothing. And the best example of that are old Christmas tree lights, where one bulb would burn out and you had to check every bulb in the whole string to find which one was burnt. It would also be impractical if somebody turned off the light in the bathroom while you were in the bedroom. So series circuits are not super practical on that end. So we have a different kind of circuit called a parallel circuit that sort of helps us to overcome these issues. So I've got a couple of other components here that I've wired to be in parallel. Okay. And what we should notice is that each one of these lights is as bright as the other. And it is as bright as one alone. And I can show that here. Another one of those advantages, if I take this light can still stay on. And if I take this one out, then we still have this one. This is as bright as this one's gonna go. As bright as this one's gonna go. So using parallel circuits within our rooms, within our homes, makes just a lot more sense.